Yeah, I don't know, man. You ever just feel like life is just catapulting towards some greater purpose?
Every fat cats with bloated ego, we are
the only DJ crazy enough to tattoo
Jackie Brown
on his ass.
This is Michael Mann, and I ride with
Extended Clip.
Welcome to Extended Clip, episode 67. I'm one of your hosts, Eddie Averill.
I'm Malcolm Baum.
I'm JT White.
And we're coming to you midweek, a little midweek surprise, a little bonus episode, breaking off from the chronology of the miniseries that we've been going through, the, you know, the films of Albert Brooks and James L. Brooks. And, you know, as Michael Caine said in the film that we watched today, mm-hmm. Brooks Brothers isn't going to be enough.
Yeah, I mean, when kind of like, you know, Tenet being really straight, it's kind of like a soldier being called back to duty, right? You love your family and, you know, you want to stay with them. You want to stay with your girlfriend, but you got to go back to Iraq and you got to get back on the battlefield. And that's, we went on back on the battlefield, the cinema.
Yeah, I mean, much like great capitalists and innovators, we saw a hole in the marketplace of Tenet criticism. And so we had to dive on in there.
You know, we record in a space that we named the Jean-Luc Godard Chris Kyle Studio for a reason, because, you know, one of our icons of the podcast, Chris Kyle, he saw what he had to do and he made multiple tours and, you know, maybe against his family's better judgment. And, you know, Jean-Luc Godard has essentially been quarantined for the last 30 years. And so I think to somewhat cut the middle there, to split the difference, we we took a drive out to beautiful Pomona, California, and looked through the haze of smog from my car and watched Christopher Nolan's big blockbuster film the way it was meant to be seen. And the way it was meant to be heard through an FM transmitter in the car and through a fairly dim outdoor projection.
Yeah, I don't know how those couples necking it in the 50s lasted that long, because the, hey, where's that movie theater IMAX quality I'm used to?
Yeah. We almost saw some old school road rage, you know, coming to the movie theater. People were so jacked up about going back to the movies that there was a little bit of a parking snafu, and we almost saw a couple get into some fisticuffs. We saw, you know, the bird was given, some harsh words were exchanged, and about 5 minutes of Tenet were lost on me because I was so distracted by the human drama that was lacking on screen but made up for in the parking lot.
Yeah, I mean, people have been out of the theater a long time. They don't know how to act, and they're going to act unruly. You let some dogs out of a cage that have been in a cage a long time, they're going to wild out.
But you know who does know how to act? John David Washington, the protagonist of Tenet. And, you know, he is the protagonist as well.
Entitled The Protagonist.
John David Washington plays a nameless CIA agent. And, you know, this is an anti-intelligence agency program. We're against, you know...
Pro-military, yeah. Anti-CIA.
Yeah. We just think they're kind of getting in there and mucking things up, you know? check all of your human ethics at the door with this one, because who cares that he's a CIA agent and that the CIA have done evil, terrible things since they're in since the first day at the office, because this film is maybe the least human of all of Nolan's, and I think that's why I ended up liking it. You know, for people who are coming to our podcast and never heard us before, and frankly, I don't think we've ever even talked about Nolan on pod before, so even our long-term listeners won't know that, yeah, I'm not a big fan, but I kind of came around on him recently checking out Interstellar, but you know, he really has to do a lot of legwork for me to like one of his movies, you know?
I mean, here's the thing ultimately for me. I haven't seen a Nolan movie in a while, but here's what's important to me. I see, you know, it's very popular to shit on Nolan, you know, it's become hack at this point. So let's try to wrap it around. Let's try to see if there's something worthwhile there. That's what I want to do when I see, you know, I might check out the new Charlie Kaufman. I don't give a shit, you know?
But the things that people generally rail against him for, I think, are here in spades, and that's why people don't seem to be taking to this film the way that they take to some of his other pictures. In terms of the human drama, the characterization, the emotions or lack thereof, yeah, this is a very robotic film. You know, it's paring everything down to The Essentials. And what it is a film about time and space and these mechanics that can be applied to action cinema without all of that nonsense like characterization and emotional catharsis.
No, just kind of looking like, you know, just looking at this movie as you do before you review it. I notice there's like no POV shots or just any like sense of humanity in like the mise-en-scene mm-hmm. whatsoever. It is a very like detached film, like even in the way it is filmed and how it like, you know, depicts characters.
Yeah. There's a part where John David Washington is going into the, you know, he's going tenet mode. They're putting him in the airlock. He's going to have to breathe, you know, through the thing. Look, there's a lot of things I'm not going to be very clear about on this podcast, but you enter this other realm of physicality, and rather than having a POV shot to establish the difference in the world, it just cuts from one shot of him to another from like basically the same angle but completely different physical perspectives, and there's really no way of telling like what the difference is until, you know, the next shot after that, when he, you know, gets into the car and tries to drive it and realize that the physics are all fucked up so he can't do it, you know. It's a really intelligent film despite seeming like it's just trying to blow your mind, you know. Like, yeah. I feel like under the surface, in terms of the patterns of editing and composition and like all of these, this kind of familiarity that builds throughout the film, I think it's working on just like so many systems that I can't understand, and like, yeah, all of this, rather than narrative logic, it's like logic of image flow. And I would be completely lying to you if I said that I got what was going on for most of this film, but I did really enjoy it.
No, yeah, I feel like I did have a kind of a bit of trouble like trying to track the plot, and then, you know, realize, you know, as you go through it, you realize it is kind of like what Nolan's obsessed with here is like the synthesis of images, you know, how they pair up against each other. And just, you know, him being interested in this particular subject kind of makes his more twist, his, you know, his tendency to go towards a twist, it makes it feel at least more meaningful, or at least he's expanding on it in like a cinematic way.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not exactly sure where I feel about it now. I think like of the Nolans that I've seen, especially the later ones, like, I definitely admire it for his, like, commitment to being, like, that formally present and, like, rigid with it. But there is a lot of it that, like, I don't know. I mean, I like, buy into, like, sort of it kind of being, like, stupid and, like, not having to take, like, the mechanics of it, like, all too seriously. But there is a lot of it for me that, like, I don't know, drags because of that.
Mm-hmm.
Like the parts where it is like, I think it works really well when it's like moving in flow, and like there are a lot of really great set pieces that work, but then it will be like chunked up with like a lot of exposition that like I don't really care about it, but I think because it divides a lot of what really works for it for me,
yeah,
it like is a big detractor.
Well, I think that division is kind of his whole approach, that, you know, explain what you're going to do and mm-hmm. then do it for a set piece and then do some more explaining. And you're also getting some explanation as it goes. And I think that this film does something with exposition that his other ones almost do but don't quite. Inception plays with exposition in a similar way, where with every single set piece you're basically like starting a new movie almost. And it's fluid in a way where you're building knowledge on top of other knowledge, even if some of that means that it's canceling itself out, rendering itself almost like a null and void. That doesn't matter because it's so much about the spectacle and the experience of going through it. As one character says in the beginning of this film, you know, don't try to understand it, just feel it. And I think that's something that I wouldn't have said holds true to any other Nolan film before, maybe Interstellar, but mainly this one, mm-hmm. you know? Because I think his dedication to spitting all that information out at you, yeah, it does get in the way in a clunky sense. And I think that's what holds back something like Inception from being a really great film, because I think it's quite good. But this one, I feel like, you know, even the way that the dialogue is mixed in the audio is calling attention to how little it almost matters. You know, like all of the physics, all the science stuff is explained, but it doesn't really matter because you could watch this as a silent film and it works almost just as well. Like, yeah. Also, which lines are punched way higher in the sound mix versus the rest of it really showcases why most of the dialogue doesn't really matter. You know, you'll have dialogue that's all very low in the mix, and then you'll have one line that is like, look at your watch or something like that. just to let you know that he could be clear and concise with everything that people say, but I prefer it this way. Yeah. As I said earlier, why bother with humanity when you have physical mechanics and images?
No, I mean, I guess to counter that, though, is like, if a lot of this exposition doesn't really matter, there is a lot of it. And a lot of it does compound in a way where it doesn't exactly hold my interest all of the time. And I mean, I think I do trend towards liking this movie rather than disliking, but sometimes the spectacle doesn't really make it up for me in that sense too. But I definitely get what you're saying, and I like it's the rhythm and pattern that it operates at. Just there's some lulls in that pattern and rhythm that I just find less interesting than others.
I agree with what you're saying in that sense, because it's like, I definitely, like, I don't know, this is the strongest positive reaction I've had from Nolan in a while, but I wish more of the spectacle was fun. Like, I like how rigid and detached it is, and I can, like, definitely get some pleasure from it, but I just wish it didn't take itself as, like, seriously. On a narrative level.
I mean, there is, like, the sailboat chase.
The sailboat chase rules.
That fucking owns, you know. Mm-hmm. Slightly obscured in the way that Nolan sometimes does, which is obnoxious. I think those shots when he pulls back from the close-ups and lets these medium shots kind of linger where they usually would have been shakier earlier in his career, it calls attention to the emptiness and the dead space, you know, on the side of some of these frames. And I think that contributes to, you know, the emptiness of the environment. It's like, it's a stretch to say it, but among many other comparisons that'll be total stretches that I'm about to make, one of them is Antonioni in the disaffected nature of everyone's performance and the gray atmosphere of everything, and it being like very much a film of either the present or the future being just such a bleak landscape that you just have these detached souls moving about the frame in the way that the director wants them to. And not even souls, bodies, you know.
Mm-hmm.
The other comparison, Don't Kill Me. I think the way that the dialogue is mixed, first and foremost, but also the way that the spatial shifts take place in this, where you will mid-conversation cut to a new location where it continues or a new conversation starts, and just the quickness with which Nolan will cut across all of his locations that he's working with for one set piece kind of reminded me of late period Malick, especially like when it's combined with that dialogue that doesn't really matter and is just kind of soaring over you as you're taking in all of these images. I don't know. I found it like to be a really beautiful film. I think that the compositions are so much, I don't want to say cleaner, but I feel like he's much more attuned to the architecture he's working with than usual.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that he really cares about is, you know, architecture within these film environments. But I think he's taking advantage of it to its fullest here. And of course, he's taking advantage of the physics. Like, you know, this is him playing with, you know, space time, the way that Interstellar, he was so obsessed with, you know, folding space. This time he's doing it with time, but their correlation between space and time, obviously, and he is able to use that to his full advantage. I think there's just so many little marvels in this film. You know, the first time he reverses the bullet, or catches the bullet, rather. And there's so many small moments like that that just, like, I don't know, reduced me to just being jaw-slacked and amazed at the movies.
I get the Malick comparison a lot, because like, though it is like about how images like interact with each other, for sure, but I think what kind of makes Malick over the top, I guess, is kind of like the romanticism flowing throughout his movies. And of course, that's not here. I'm not expecting it. You
that's
know what I mean?
Also what keeps me from comparing it to digital Michael Mann as
And with Antonioni, I also get the Antonioni thing as well, but I think Nolan leaves no room in his movies for acting whatsoever. And where it's like, where some of these, like someone like Monica Vitti could, you know, deliver a great performance within like this gray disaffectedness. I mean, there is like, I mean, he could have casted anyone in this movie. It doesn't really matter.
I think John David Washington's really great.
He definitely is. He definitely stands out as the best performance.
And it's just like those slight alterations in his cadence or pitch when he goes slightly higher and it's slightly resemblant of his father really stand out because of how low key the whole performance is and how perfect he is within this milieu. Him and Pattinson, you know, the most humanity they'll show is like a slight smile, you know, and yeah. exchange about whether he likes club soda or Diet Coke.
You know, people say Malick is humorless, and I think he is humorless in the way that none of his characters have a sense of humor, but there's like funny, awkward moments that arise out of kind of like, whether intentional or not, I think some of them are definitely intentional, but that like kind of lets, you know, I feel like lighten some of the criticisms I would have thrown at Nolan for, you know, some of his other movies.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, something like the scene, the kitchen fight scene, I think is very funny and one of the more creative things I've seen Nolan do in a fight, you know, some cheese grater action and stuff like that.
Dude, I can't believe we got to see fucking Washington fucking take a cheese grater to a guy's face in a Nolan movie. Like, he's clearly having fun. Like, that's his version of having fun, is having a character named the protagonist, you know, use a cheese grater to kill an anonymous bad guy, you know. And I think all the fights in this are like really, I hate to use this as a compliment, but because it's kind of just a backhanded compliment towards his older films, but surprisingly responsibly choreographed and framed action for the most part in this. Like the fist fight where Washington is, you know, we learn later, fighting himself, is really well done. And I think all of the inversions are so beautiful. I mean, if you don't know anything about this movie, they basically figure out how to reverse time. And so all of the action set pieces that you see in the first half are then shown again. Or not watching it, rather, taking part of it inversed. And, you know, we kind of talked about this with deja vu and, you know, reinserting yourself into an action set piece in that film much more for an emotional reason. In this film, because a guy is doing his job that he doesn't really know what the job is until he finds out that it's actually his job because he's the boss.
No, yeah, that is works at CEO of my life type moment.
Dude, honestly, this film is like, this film also definitely reminded me of the Male Soul Instagram for sure.
Oh, 100%.
Especially Kenneth Branagh's Russian like dude character. Is that Kenneth Branagh?
I was going to say, is that him? Wow.
Yeah. That accent was not so strong, and his you know, male motivation was off the charts though.
Yeah, he's like a guy who's supposed to be happy in a Male Soul post, but he's like the depressed guy in a Male Soul post. Like, you know, everyone always has time to talk to you. If someone isn't texting you back, they're doing it on purpose. That's Male Soul. Not me, I would never say that.
But, I mean, with what you were getting at of, like, the deja vu comparison was really apt, and, like, I thought of it a lot when they were inverting things. And I like that segment a whole lot, but I just feel like the first half sort of building up to it where it's like it's dropping the clues for like when you like watch it again, or like that now that you're aware of, oh, they're going to be like flipping the set pieces around. It like, I don't know, the way they go through it at first falls a little flat for me.
Mm-hmm. Well, maybe you just have to watch it twice.
Well, I mean, I think for me, I
think someone's just too cool for Nolan right now.
No. You want to defend yourself? No, no. I mean, more for me, it's like I was just trying to figure out what was going on. You know what I mean? And I think it is like intentionally confusing, which I think I kind of, you know, caught on to. And when I think of Nolan, I think as someone who would want to make his Easter eggs well known and like kind of like, you know, enough for someone, you know, just to cherry pick it, and they're like, oh shit, it came back late. That's how I always thought of Nolan, as someone who like kind of like made like movies like you figure out, but yeah. like they're easy to figure out, so you feel smart for figuring them out.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas this is like he's kind of made something that's impenetrable,
yeah,
has its kind of like own logic that doesn't entirely connect for me. Maybe it's there, maybe I'm just dumb, but like I do respect it at that with that quality.
Yeah. I also like Robert Pattinson's character as someone who just kind of has a different set of information than John David Washington, you know, mm-hmm. and that's all it is just how much each character knows about their own process, because none of these characters fully know what's going on,
mm-hmm.
you know, even the people telling John David Washington what to do, as it turns out, don't know what's going on the further you go, you know, and if we're confusing you, you know, to semi quote the film, you know, stay out of the chopper if you can't stop thinking in linear time.
Yeah, I mean, I think that is ultimately Nolan's goal, is like, come play this game with me. Come play yeah. this game I've invented of like kind of the mishmashing of time and like what kind of fun can we have with this, and like action sequences, things blowing up from different perspectives, you know, that's where the fun really comes out in the movie.
Yeah.
Will you play with Nolan? He wants to come out and play.
I'm down to play. The set piece in like Siberia toward the end, where you just have like two military units running at each other, one moving forward, one moving backward in time. A lot of it is just like the spectacle of seeing that many bodies being moved together, you mm-hmm. know, with all of these reversed explosions happening. But there's one really remarkable part where there's a building that gets blown up with an RPG. And, you know, since it's in reverse, people are shouting it out like, oh, the building's going to get blown up, you know. So they're able to reverse the explosion. But then the squad that's moving forward in time just undoes it by shooting it with another RPG. And just seeing a building like implode and then reverse and then explode from like a different angle is just like, I don't know, something I haven't seen in a movie really. And then there's also a part where an airplane, they just roll it into a fucking hangar and it just blows up like the area where people wait for their planes. And I thought that was pretty cool too. You know, this is a lot of destruction in this movie.
Yeah, yeah. I guess, you know, IMDb trivia, I guess that they really just ran a plane into a building. That was real. Like for
that
the
fucking
movie.
Rules.
Nolan's creating his own personal 9/11s just for the movie world.
That's the other thing. Everyone on Twitter was like, is this movie about 9/11? Dude, it's going to be epic. This movie's about 9/11.
It's about how people don't remember 9/11 correctly.
Like, go watch Postal if you want a movie about 9/11.
Yeah, that is like a thing. People are like, what's the best movie about 9/11? I think Postal actually might be.
Probably.
Well, you could learn it's not the best movie, but you'll learn the most.
Yeah. Oh boy. So I think that like this just continues with Nolan stripping back like the unnecessary human aspects of his films, you know, and also cleaning up his compositions a lot in his continued collaboration with Van Hoytema compared to his old DP Wally Pfister, whose frames were often cluttered and overly gray. I think there's a lot of beauty in the gray of Hoytema's shots for him, especially in this and Dunkirk and Interstellar. But, you know, between this and Dunkirk, he is really just making movies about experiments in time, space, action, and folding them into narrative logic. And I think that's really admirable to be doing on such a big budget level. And also, we didn't mention that the film ends with a Travis Scott song.
Yeah.
And then we went right to McDonald's and got the Travis Scott burger. Mark Fisher would not be happy with us, I think.
Straight up. Well, Mark Fisher would have definitely accepted whatever this is by now. You
yeah.
know what I mean? I mean, you know, the Travis Scott burger is, you know, you're already late if that's the thing that catches you.
Any final thoughts on this one before we wrap it on up?
Yeah. I mean, I think I'm ultimately mixed. See, I literally can't say words. I'm so mixed on this movie. No, because I did like a good amount of it, and I did zone out for a little bit too. And some of it, I was parsing rather than experiencing. But I really do think he does have something interesting here. And I kind of want, you know, drive-in's great. Would rather have, you know, a little home viewing where, because I didn't really have a chance to really analyze, I guess, like cinematography or anything like that. That it didn't I had a harder time processing that with through the drive-thru or drive-in.
Drive-thru.
Drive-thru movies. I mean, 2 hours and 30 minutes. That's what am I at, In-N-Out, you know?
That's for our California listeners. You going to give this one a bullet rating?
Yeah, I'll give it 3 reverse bullets.
What about you, JT?
Yeah, I'm also going to go 3 bullets, but I'm shooting them forward in time.
You're on the red team. He's on the blue team.
Yeah.
Blue that was belt. A little Halo red versus blue action. Think about it. Calling back to the cinema greats of the early internet.
Yeah, now I feel like I have a lot more respect for Nolan than I did in the past. Like, I think I don't know. It's more apparent to me than when I was a kid, like what he's trying to do with a very cold, like calculating style. And I would like to see more experiments that are like Tenet, where he's sort of embracing like his fixations and just playing with time and like reality, and it's like the inessentials are sort of stripped away. But at the same time, like, while I admire what he's doing, it's not necessarily as fun as something that, like, I don't know, while I was watching this, I was thinking a lot about Gemini Man, because I think that's like comparable in like a relationship where it's like the past and like future images sort of colliding together. And also, I don't know, just like a big, crazy, like high tech blockbuster. And I think, I don't know, just something like Gemini Man works a lot more for me, because while like, and again, I think it's like a similar issue with both of the movies have bad scripts. And I think Gemini Man can overcome its script because it embraces that melodrama in how it's shot, and it does have that human connection. And that's why I feel like something like Tenet leaves me cold, but still giving it a salute.
I actually also thought about Gemini Man for a couple of shots during this, you know, the car chase. And then, of course, there's some shots of Elizabeth Debicki over a large vista of, you know, greenery and some water as well. And I was like, hey, this reminds me of Gemini Man for some strange reason. I don't know what it was. Maybe it's just the feeling of being at the cinema and feeling great about myself. I think I like this about as much as Gemini Man. I think this is like kind of a great film. And the more I talk through it, like, it's not even the kind of thing where the more I talk through it, the more I get it and love it. The more I talk through it, the more I just want to watch it again. Because I... Look, man, you gotta see this thing twice. But I really do think that this will open up for me more on second viewing. So I'm taking a bet with my rating, because it might go down on a second viewing too. But I think that like what Nolan is doing stylistically here is just like a further progression towards something I like from him. And I feel like I'm getting so much more out of his movies now that I'm setting aside all of the things people hate, you know.
Yeah.
You go on Twitter, yeah, you ask people, what do you think about Christopher Nolan? And, you know, you get a barrage of, oh, it's all exposition. He doesn't care about his woman characters. They're all dead wives, you know.
She's alive in this one.
Yeah. Hey. And she's kicking butt too.
Slaying, even if you
I was letting you sit with that one.
I'm completely satisfied.
I really like Elizabeth Debicki's performance in this one. I mean, she has a lot of fucking information to get out there, and she does it. It's like, what else are you gonna say?
Yeah, I mean, it's good in like a car gets you there.
No, I legitimately think like her physicality kind of embodies the mood of this film, because she is like, you know, obviously it's Elizabeth Debicki. She's like 8'5" or whatever, with like that very slender frame and like slickly maneuvering through the frame, but also very coldly and very precisely, and also just spouting out all of the information, you know. I feel like her detachment works more than Kenneth Branagh kind of going bozo mode, even though I did like that because it was a nice touch. That was kind of like a wild card thing. Like, I really didn't expect Branagh's style of performance in this. Even if I can't say it was good, I liked how off-putting it was.
Yeah, I mean, it does, like, in terms of, like, the framework of the film, it is, like, kind of refreshing. Because when I was saying to Bicky's, like, it's good, like, in a car gets you, it's not a criticism of her, just kind of more maybe Nolan is like allowed, because it's information saying.
Yeah,
you
she's
know
like
I mean?
My 2015 Prius. She got us there.
And that's something to be admired.
Oh, I love my car.
We love cars here. We love our love our rides. We're going Jay Leno for the pod from now on.
Oh, God.
You hear about these inversions? You know, pretty soon you're going to see Jay Leno driving his car backwards after seeing this one.
I think that the end is really great because it is slightly open-ended. You know, you get that nice wrap it up with a bow and, you know, the voiceover about preventing the bombs that you never knew were going to go off or whatever, which, you know, is the whole point of the film.
And
the
CIA.
Look, if you think about it, the ramifications of that ending could mean that, you know, the further back we go on the other timeline, they're preventing 9/11. They're not starting the CIA. They're abolishing the United States of America
as
we know it.
That's kind of the opposite of what I meant. I said, I think it means it's about the bombs you don't see that go up. It's about the crimes you see that aren't committed yet.
I know that. I know.
Well, I got to get my point across because some people might want to corrupt it, you know?
Anyway, I give this one 4 bullets. It's Christopher Nolan's best picture, perhaps. I've only gone as high as 3.5 for Interstellar because that one made me weep like a little baby. But that one did, like, you know, slow down in spots, and there's some stuff I'm not crazy about in that one. But this one, oh man, stone cold, baby. I didn't feel a single thing, but I loved it.
Well, I definitely want to rewatch it, and that's definitely a compliment.
Yeah. We will be back on Thursday, right? Regularly scheduled programming, back to the Brooks Brothers, because you know what, Michael Caine? Brooks Brothers is enough. We're going to be talking about I'll Do Anything, James L. Brooks's film Maudite, and Albert Brooks's Modern Romance. So we'll see you then.
All right. Stay safe, everyone.
Turn up.
Turn up.
The best way to experience this movie would be, if you have to watch it, turn it on TV at home when it comes out on DVD and turn the sound completely off. And then, as you're cleaning the house or you've got a party going on and you need the kids to stay occupied, that'll make this a lot more
interesting. That's how I had to watch incest porn.
What?
You gotta turn the sound down. Then it's just porn.
I'm so confused. Okay.